Bring all your failures, bring your addictions, come lay them down at the foot of the cross. Jesus is waiting there with open arms.
For God so loved,
for God so loved the world that he gave us, his one and only Son to save us. Whoever believes in him will live forever.
The power of hell.
The power of hell forever defeated. Now it is well. I'm walking in freedom. For God so loved, God so loved the world. For God so loved the world that he gave us, his one and only Son to save us. Whoever believes in him will live forever. The power of hell forever defeated. Now it is well. I'm walking in freedom. For God so loved, God so loved the world.
Praise God,
praise God, praise God, from whom all blessings flow. Praise him, praise him, for the wonders of his love. Praise God, praise God, from whom all blessings flow. Praise him, for the wonders of his love. For God so loved the world that he gave us, his one and only Son to save us. Whoever believes in him will live forever. The power of hell forever defeated. Now it is well. I'm walking in freedom. For God so loved, God so loved the world.
One more time.
For God so loved the world that he gave us, his one and only Son to save us. Whoever believes in him will live forever. The power of hell forever defeated. Now it is well. I'm walking in freedom. For God so loved, God so loved the world.
Bring all your failures.
Bring all your failures. Bring your addictions. Come lay them down at the foot of the cross. Jesus is waiting. God so loved the world.
Such powerful words.
He became sin who knew no sin, that we might become his righteousness. He humbled himself and carried the cross. Love so amazing. Love so amazing. Jesus Messiah, name above all names. blessed Redeemer, Emmanuel, a rescue for sinners, a ransom from heaven, Jesus Messiah, Lord of all. His body the bread, his blood the wine, broken and poured out, all for love.
Good morning, everybody. We're going to get started this morning. And, you know, today has been very cold first thing in the morning. Like minus 20, welcome to winter. Global warming at its finest, and then sometime this week, it's supposed to go up to plus 6, which is going, okay, well, let's see how much snow goes, and then it comes back again a little bit later. You know, it'd be okay with me if it snowed at the end of November and left at the middle of January.
Yes.
That, to me, would be wonderful, you know. And we all have our certain reasons behind that, but you know what? I won't go there. Listen, this morning as we get started, you know what? I'm excited to see what God's going to do today. Because, you know, when things don't always go smoothly, and we know that there's that back push, we know that God is about to do something. And so I really pray that you are prepared and come with an expectant heart to see what God wants to do. This morning, do you have that expectancy? Are you there? Right. So we're going to pray that God would just stir that in our hearts this morning. Just a couple of things before we go into prayer. Day planners. How many of you have this day planner? Okay. This day planner, we have to order. We have to order within the next couple weeks. So we are asking that if you would like a day planner, it's going to cost you $10 this year. But if you would like this day planner, I would suggest that you will get a hold of Kelly, email the church, or call Kelly. I'm so thankful she's here. You know, God has done, and you know, and maybe she should give a testimony, but many of you won't hear. But God touched her last Sunday as we prayed for her, and God brought a healing, and she started to get that flute movement in her arm. And now I've got to back away because then she can punch me, right? But you know what? God is at work, and you know, we believe that God brought healing. So get a hold of Kelly if you want this, because we have to get them ordered so they're here in time for next year, right? So if we order them December 25th, we're going to get them at January 30th or February, whatever. So we want to get them ordered as soon as possible. So let Kelly know. And we need to get the money in for that. Also, coming November the 13th and 14th, one of the things that we wanted to do was downstairs where Scotty's office was, that's going to become a storage unit. So we get everything that's spread throughout the church and get some organization down there. And Aileen is stepping up, and she's going to give this direction on where we're going. So by November the 8th, you have to let Aileen know if you can help. We need about, what, six people that will be able to come in on the Saturday, which is the 14th, and put together all the shelves. We need somebody to pick up the material.
I've already got it covered.
You've got that part covered. Awesome. So the material will be here. We're going to have saws here. We got screwdrivers. You can bring your power screwdriver, you know. Yeah, I just do the donuts, right? But make sure you have your everything that you're going to need to do the work. And so it's going to be here and ready. But on the 13th, which is the Friday, we need help moving everything out of that room into the hallway, because you can't do the shelves with everything in there. So we need help to get everything out and then get the shelves done and move it back in. So by November the 8th, please let Aileen know so that we've got this organized and directed. All right, we have Operation Christmas Child. Amy, did you want to come and share a bit with... No, she is on.
So growing up, life was really tough for me and my family. We couldn't afford the basic things.
I raised in poor family.
In the orphanage, we did not have anything that was ours.
And I didn't expect anything.
I remember opening it, and inside, there was so much color,
like the rainbow.
And I was just so happy to have a gift for myself.
And I loved it.
How could so many beautiful things be packed in one box? And who would have done such a thing?
Till this day, it impacts me. Till this day, I feel the love of God.
Thank you for being a blessing in my life without even knowing me.
In that moment, I realized how God was in my life.
God has been so faithful to me. I just want to say thank you.
The shoebox represented his love and his redemption in my life.
So those are just some of the lives, and that shows what a shoebox does to impact a community, a child, and ultimately a life for eternity. So again, shoeboxes are at the back here. And if you want to pack online, you just have to go on the website, Operation Christmas Child. There'll be a place that you just hit pack online, and you can pack it right online. What I'm going to ask, though, if you pack it online and you're from our church, let me know. And I'm going to put a label on our tree as we fill it up with shoeboxes so we can also see the pack online boxes that we've done. And for those who are online, if you're not from this area, you can go and check out in your area where your shoeboxes can go. They'll be online where collection sites and stuff are. You can pick up boxes in your own community. Or if you can't find any, you guys can also go online. Doesn't matter what country you're in. There's that online option to pack. And yeah, happy packing.
There's a number of issues when you start packing shoeboxes. Amy and I were given the privilege to go to Uruguay to hand out the shoeboxes. And what an incredible privilege that was. It just changed our hearts to see these kids receiving these boxes. And then when we went from there, I had gone to the Philippines, and while I was in the Philippines, just before I was leaving, they were going to be handing out the shoeboxes. And the place that they were handing it out was in such need. Downtown Manila, where the open market is and kids are taken at 3 years old and just dumped there, left by their parents, and they have to fend for themselves. You can imagine all the horror that takes place with a three-year-old running around not sure what's next for them. But this church was giving out shoeboxes in one way or another, touching the life of a child. Then when we had an opportunity to go, and trust me, this we had opportunities. It was somehow God intervened, and we were able to go to Hawaii as well. And while we were there, we were at the churches, and this one church was doing the Operation Christmas Child. And again, the joy, and just to pack them was just impacting for us. You know, I still have the pictures of this place, and they were just so excited about being able to serve in this way. And it does have impact in people's lives. I've been given a name of a person in town who had received a Christmas shoebox, and I'm working right now to see if we can get her to come and share her story. If it works, that we just pray that that would be an opportunity. So those are some of the announcements, but we're going to go into time of prayer this morning. And I just have a few things down here. The Presbyterian Church, we want to pray for that church today, and we want to pray for Dava and Lily. The Presbyterian Church, Dave and Lily are leaving as of October the 30th, so that the end of this week they are gone out of our community. And with this, the Presbyterian Church is needing a pastor. And you know, when we see a church without a pastor, it all of a sudden, especially with Christmas, you know, we have to look at Christmas as an opportunity to reach out. And when this happens, there's a floundering and kind of not, unsure and what's next. And so we just want to pray for the Presbyterian Church and for Dava and Lily. Also, we want to continue to pray for Rudy. They found a lump in his throat. They don't know what it was, and they're not going to test it. And you know what? He's on his way to heaven. But doesn't hurt when we see a friend. So, we want to continue to pray for Rudy. Kelly Klein is sick, and so he's asking for prayer. And for Darlene's sister, Linda, who just died in her sleep. Jay did. Linda is your other sister. Jay is the one that died. I got to make sure I put that down too, because I'll make a mistake. So Darlene's sister, Jay, who passed away in her sleep. And Linda, her other sister, called her. And it's been a real struggle for her. And we can imagine during these times. It's not easy, is it? So those are just some of the things now. What else do we see that we need prayer for? What's going on?
I have a praise report.
Yeah.
Last week we asked for prayer for John because he was going to Northern Ontario.
Yeah.
No problems, got there and back home safely.
Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. John got there and back. That's awesome. That's good news. We got to have praise reports too. Anything else? Okay. Well, we're going to pray this morning. Father, I thank you for your mercy, your grace that's extended to us each day. Father, we thank you that we can come before your throne and we can lay these things before you. Lord, we don't always understand the end result, or we don't understand how that's going to work, but one thing we do know, that you are God and there is no other, that you sit on the throne, and Father, we can trust you and we can lay these things before you, asking, Lord, for your hand to come and move in these places. Father, we lift up the Presbyterian Church to you today. Lord, as now they are going to be facing some uncertainty, and we pray, Lord, for them. And we ask you, Lord, for your wisdom to come on that leadership, Lord, as they press into this next season and all that they're facing right now. Lord, would you help them? Father, we pray for Dava and Lily. Well, Father, with all the circumstances of this, Lord, we all don't know. And so, God, we just lay that before you and say, God, would you be with Dave and Lily? Lord, would you settle their hearts? Lord, because even at this time, the unsettledness that can come with this. So, Lord, let your peace just surround them right now, Father. They know your presence, Father. Father, today we lift up Rudy to you. And I thank you, Lord, for his witness that he has been and he continues being. I thank you, Father, for what you've done in his life and how you've worked in his life and you've brought him into this place. And Lord, you have not left him. He is safe in your arms. And God, even today, Lord, as he's facing another challenge, God, we lift him up before your throne and we say, God, would you come and touch him, Lord, today. Touch him, Lord, today. Lord, we pray also today for Kelly, and we pray, Lord, for your healing touch on his life. Lord, with this cold and everything else, Lord, just touch him. Restore him, we pray, in Jesus' name. We pray, Father, for Darlene's sister, Linda, who is devastated with her other sister, Jay's death. Lord, death comes and it reminds us and it tells us to look, what is it in the future? What do we believe? Where do we go? And I just pray, Father, for peace for Darlene today. I pray, give her strength today. And even as she talks with her sister, Linda, Lord, that she would have words of comfort. And Lord, that you would just bring people across Linda's path that can share Jesus. And Father, for Jay's family in Ontario, Lord, we pray for them. And we pray, Lord, that you again, in that situation, bring someone in. Bring people in that would just speak into that family's lives. God, we lift that before your throne. Father, for all the unspoken requests, Father, whether it's online or whether it's just here, Lord, we pray, Lord, that you hear from heaven as they cry out to you. Lord, for those who are needing finances, those who are needing work, those who are struggling emotionally, Lord, we just lift them up before you. And Father, I want to thank you also for answering prayer as John went and drove out east and back safely. Lord, thank you for your goodness in that as well. And Father, now we just lift up this service. Lord, would you come and would you meet with each person? And Lord, as we will engage with you, whether it's through song or in through the word, Lord, we just want to pray, God, that we might engage with you. We would have ears to hear, hearts to receive, and a willingness to respond to the moving of your Holy Spirit. We ask this all in Jesus' name. Amen.
Well, if you guys would like to stand with Betty, because the rest of us are thing, we're just going to sing some songs. This week, I had actually a hard time trying to get a list together because everything was slow. Everything was just, I guess I just wanted to worship. But it's been the cry of my heart that no matter what I do, God would get glory. And so let us together give God the glory that he deserves.
This day we're gathered in your name, calling out to you. Your glory like a fire, awakening desire, will burn our hearts with truth. You're the reason we're here. You're the reason we're singing. Open up the heavens, we want to see. Presence in this place, your glory on our face, we're looking to the sky, descending like a cloud, you're standing with us now, Lord, unveil our eyes, you're the reason we're here, you're the reason we're singing, open up the heavens, we want to see you, open open. I want to touch you. to the beginning. Can't control what tomorrow will bring, but I know here in the middle is the place where you promised to be.
You come, will you meet me here again? 'Cause all I want is all you are. Will you meet me here again?
As I walk now through the valley, let your love rise above every fear. Like the sun shaping the shadow, in my weakness your glory appears.
I'm not enough. Thank you.
place. I worship you. I worship you. You are here, moving in our midst. I worship you. Darkness, my God, that is who you
Surrender ourselves to you, everything we have, everything we want. And we just praise you, for we are fearfully and wonderfully made. And I just ask that you go with us through the rest of the service and continue speaking in Jesus' name. Amen.
for each of us to get moving into and pressing into the very presence of the Lord. When we start to pray and ask God to come, do you know His promise is that if we ask, He will come? And we don't have to wonder and sit back and go, did He come? No, He's here. It's just our hearts need to be open and responsive to what He'd have to say to us this morning. So before we get going too much farther, we're going to pray for the kids, and then we're going to let them go, and then we'll move forward. So let's just pray. Father, thank You so much for Your presence here. I thank You, Lord, that You are working, even when we don't see it, even when we don't feel it, that God, that You are at work, and we trust You in this. And we know that we can walk wholly and completely in You. Father, this morning, we just lift up the kids as they go to Sunday school. We pray, God, that You would give help them to hear what is being spoken, and that God, that You'd that their eyes would just be opened right open to see You. Lord, they can hear You, they can know You. Jesus, You invited the kids to come to You. For such is the kingdom of heaven. And so, God, we just lift that time up with You. We pray for Amy and whoever's helping, God, that You just be with them. And Lord, bless their time together. As we spend time here, Lord, to hear Your word, we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, so the kids can go. Did you want your water, Tim? I'm just saying, it's here. Yeah, all right. Well, this morning we're going to continue our discussion on the armor of God. And I don't know about you, but I find that when I'm doing the studying, I learn more than when I'm sitting there. So I would encourage you to take some time to really look through it and really take the time to say, God, what are You saying to me? And this morning, we're going on to the shoes. But we've already talked about the belt or truth like a belt around our waist. And I'm praying that God has stirred you to make sure you have truth around your waist. And that and righteousness like a breastplate. It's that, again, we talked about the choice. You have a choice, and that choice is whether you're going to follow God or not. He said, follow Me. And when we make the choice, we're going to say, God, I'm going to do what You want me to do. I'm going to live the way You want me to live. To live righteously is where we come into while we put on righteousness like a breastplate. So this morning, we're going to start we're going to go on to the shoes. So if you turn your Bibles to Ephesians chapter 6, and this is where we've been, and I just want to read this for us again, just giving us a start on what this is saying. Ephesians chapter 6 and verse 10, it says, finally, be strengthened by the Lord and by His vast strength. Put on the full armor of God so that you can stand against the schemes of the devil. I want you to remember, too, that this is the very beginning. It says, this is the armor of God. This is not yours. It is God's armor that He's given to you. It's not in our own strength, but it is in the strength of the Holy Spirit that dwells within us, that we can start to put these on. And it's meant for us to stand against the devil's schemes, his plans and his purposes to keep us from being fruitful or unpurposeful. It's to keep us back from doing what God has called us to do. For our struggle is not against flesh and blood. So often we think about it. We're fighting against people, but it's not. It's against principalities and powers, against the rulers of darkness of this age, against evil spiritual forces in the heavens. For this reason, take up the full armor of God so that you may be able to resist in the evil day. And having prepared everything to take your stand, stand therefore with truth like a belt around your waist, righteousness like armor on your chest, and your feet sandaled with the readiness for the gospel of peace. In every situation, take up the shield of faith with which you can extinguish all the flaming arrows of the evil one. Take up the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God. Pray at all times in the Spirit with every prayer and request, and stay alert with all perseverance and intercession for all the saints. this is where we're going to end. But this morning, I just want to encourage us that, you know, there's a plan and a purpose that Satan will use to try and trip us up or get us distracted. And I've been, even this morning, I've experienced distraction. I've faced some stuff and I'm going, God, I just need to come back into your presence. I need to come back into that place. And what is it that I need to, where is it that I need to make sure that I'm walking in and just reapplying that armor just to understand what it is. And God, do I want to make sure I have that truth. What is that truth? What is that righteousness? And then the shoes and the faith. And faith is one of those things that we stand. We stand against the powers of the enemy in faith. And we're going to be dealing with that in a couple weeks. But this morning, again, we're coming back to the shoes. And I just want to let you know that I stand in the same place as a very famous preacher did. We have the same background. His name was D.L. Moody. How many have heard of D.L. Moody? Okay, D.L. Moody and I have something in common. He's a lot older than I am, obviously. He's not even around. But you know, D.L. Moody and I have something in common. Together, we sold shoes. He was a shoe salesman, and so was I. He left the shoes, and he became an evangelist. I didn't quit my shoes and become an evangelist. I quit my shoes, worked in the retail as well, then went into insurance, and then here I am. But for the first 6 years of Amy's in my life, I was a shoe salesman. And as a shoe salesman, one of the things that I kept telling people, I says, if you want to go anywhere, if you want to be good in business, right, Ed, you want to be good in business. If you want to do that, do not become a shoe salesman. Do you know why? Because you'll always see defeat. All right, that was not... No, it's, you know, there's so many stories that, you know, you can be tongue-tied. Anyways, you're very soulish. Anyways, here it is. One of the things that I learned that's so important about proper footwear for what you're doing is because I've done this a number of times, is if you're struggling with back pain or hip pain or even knee pain, if all I have to do is look at the bottom of your shoes, I could see how you walk. And as you walk, I could see, okay, if you're walking in a certain way and your shoes are worn out, it will eventually have effect on your knees. It will affect your hips and will affect your lower back. And we know that if your shoes are not proper, and there's shoes that you need to have for every occasion. When I worked in the shoe store, I worked on a lot of cement. And I started to wear shoes that were... I had to wear dress shoes, but they didn't have good soles on them. But after an 8-hour day, my feet hurt. My legs hurt. And you know that because some of you, if you have problems with your feet, you know that if you don't have proper footwear, that's not going to be good for you. And so I've learned that I have to spend a little bit more money on proper footwear. And this footwear only lasts me about a year because I'm hard on my shoes. But it's very important for you to have proper footwear because it has effect on your whole entire life. Now, James and Betty Robeson on Life Today, every Christmas, and I'm not just promoting them, but I want to make sure we remember about the Christmas shoeboxes, but every year at Christmas time, James and Betty Robeson have a program where they want to deliver shoes to those kids in the third world country. Because many of them are running around without shoes, and they're walking and working in garbage dumps. And if you think that that's not true, listen, I saw it personally when I went to the Philippines, and I went to the ballot box, which is the dump site, and we went and we served there, and these little kids are in the dump going through all the scraps looking for what they could get so they could build it together so they can sell it so that they could have food. Now, when they get into this dump site, you got to remember that everything is thrown in there. So what else can be in there? You can put tin is in there. You can have glass in there. You can have other sharp objects, wood objects, nails, everything goes in. And as these kids are walking and they hurt their feet, what ends up happening is they get a disease and their feet get a lot of sores. And then eventually it can bring them to death. They can die because their feet have not been taken care of. And this is what James and Betty Robeson do in this, is they go out and they give shoes to kids that are impoverished and they have they need help with their feet. And even as Amy and I have watched this show, and it comes on at 10 o'clock at night, but we watch and we see some of the horrendous diseases in these kids' feet. And I tell you these things because I want you to remember and take note that shoes are ultimately important if you're going to continue to walk or stand. Because if you don't have the right shoes, you will not be able to stand. You know, there's different shoes made for different activities. And when I was in the shoe store, I used to sell different shoes for these different activities. And one of them that you need is for baseball. How many know that you cannot just wear regular running shoes in a baseball game? If you're going to play a bit, well, if you just throw in, you need to have proper, because you've got to have grip. Or if you're going to play rugby, or if you're going to play football, you need to have the proper shoes. Also, if you're going to go hiking, and if you want to know any good shoes, talk to Dennis. I've gone hiking with Dennis, and I've wore running shoes, and I ended up with blisters. You think I would have a better idea. And then I finally got myself some hiking shoes, but I didn't wear the right socks. And so the socks, if you're not wearing proper socks, your feet sweat and you get blisters. And you know what? It's not fun walking up a mountain with blisters. And it's even harder coming down. But whenever you have these shoes, you need to make sure you have, or if whatever activity you're doing, you have to make sure you have the right shoes. Now, there's another situation. Before I got into shoes, I used to work in a warehouse. We used to work at Sears. And if you want to know the jingle for Sears, I can tell you right now, come on, come on in, come on in to friendliness. Anyways, I heard that every morning. And it's just as bad as some Christmas carols. Okay? Because I hear these Christmas carols, and they're just like, come on, have a holly jolly Christmas. Yeah, you want to have a holly jolly? I'll show you a holly jolly. Anyways, I worked at Sears, and one of the things that you had to do in Sears is you had to have proper work boots with steel toes because you were moving heavy stuff. And if you want to know about steel toes, you can talk to anyone like Matt, who has to have steel toes at work. Doug, you know what? If Doug does not have steel toes and he's out there and he drops this stuff on his feet, how many know that that's not going to last very long? He's going to have to take some time off to get his feet healed up. You see, shoes are utterly important for your lives. So as we go on, we're going to talk about the soldier's shoes. Because Paul was sitting there in jail and he was looking at soldiers and he saw their shoes and he understood their shoes. And what he did was he wanted to understand the shoes, but then he moved them on to the place where he told them about the believer's shoes. And he says this, he says, put on the shoes, the preparation of the gospel of peace. Because if the shoes are not there, then you are going to be in trouble. And then we're going to say, how do we put them on? Now, again, we just finished reading about the shoes, but I wanted to bring it back to the context. The context of this scripture is all about standing firm. It's not about the going out. However, there is that part of it. When you're in a battle, you've got to move forward. But at this point, Paul is telling them, I want you to be able to stand firm after doing everything to stand. Stand firm, therefore, with your shoes on. Against the schemes of the devil. We just stand against them because he is going to render you and I unproductive. If you're not wearing your shoes, he's going to cause you to become unproductive and unfruitful. So let me give you the soldier's shoes. If you say that five times, soldier's shoes, I feel like a tongue twister. The Roman soldiers had a special sandal for battle. One of the defensive weapons that they came against was this, is they would take little pieces of wood and or sticks, and they'd put sharp points to it, and they'd hide them into the ground so that when the other army was coming against you, if they weren't wearing shoes or if they weren't wearing the proper shoes, they would come into the battle and step on these spikes or the common day landmines, and it would stop them and render them useless. In fact, it would be so bad that they would be taken and killed quickly because they hurt their feet. Now, these sandals also had to be tied up, and the sandal of the Roman soldier was mainly a sole with straps that went up and around the ankles and the calf, holding the sandal tight to his foot. And these sandals also had, so you had to, they had to be made sure that they were tight and wrapped around the foot properly. And then we'll come to that important part too. But these also had spikes on them. These shoes also had spikes down in, because just like golf shoes or like your baseball shoes or football shoes, the spikes gave you sure-footedness. Because when they fought, they would either fight, they could fight in rain. And you know, as well as I do, if you are walking on grass in the rain, it is slippery. And yet with the Roman soldiers' sandals, they could plant their feet, get them right in there, and you ain't moving them. They have stability and their sure-footedness. And if they're in a battle and there's rocks there, they could literally get their shoe pushed into the rocks to give them stability. Or if the battle was raging hard and the field was full of blood, and they don't want to think of gruesome thoughts, but you got to realize this is what they're battling in, and they had to make sure they were sure-footed, because the worst thing that would ever happen to a soldier right now is if they were to slip and fall. If you're in battle, hand-to-hand battle with somebody, you do not want to fall, because that's where you are down and you are at a disadvantage. And the chances of death are high. So the spikes were helped to maintain footwear, their footing. And the spikes allowed them to stand firm, just like we've been reading. Having done all to stand, stand firm therefore. So if you want to be able to stand, make sure you have the proper footwear. In real similar story about sporting events today, track or soccer, football and baseball, all shoes have some sort of spikes or plastic knobs on them so that they can keep the athlete in better footing. And it's the same thing today for us. The sandals didn't provide much way of protection, but they, except for them from the spikes coming up. But they certainly helped the soldier stay on his feet. And we'll get to the hiking boots too. They may not have spikes. Well, some have to if you're going to do hiking on ice. When last time I went ice climbing, David went with us, and we had to climb up a 30, 40, out at Frontier. I think it's got to be a 40-foot high ice wall. And you had to put spikes on your shoes so you can kick it in. But you see, the spikes were so important. You see, the soldier could be outfitted the most invincible armor from head to foot, except down to his ankles. But if he didn't have good footwear, he couldn't keep going. And when your feet hurt badly, you can't even stand, much less fight or march. So it was essential for the soldiers to have proper footwear. Now, how does that work for Christians? How do we have to deal with these shoes? We have to put them on, and as we put these on, it talks about the putting on the shoes, and again in verse 15, and your feet sandaled with readiness for the gospel of peace. There are two views that are explained with these shoes, and one of these ways was the readiness to preach the gospel of peace. When we are told to put on the shoes, one of the thoughts is you make sure you're ready to declare or to proclaim the gospel of peace whenever you have need to. Much as the scripture says, always be prepared to give the reason of the hope that lies within you. And there's other scriptures of Isaiah 52 and verse 7, as well as Romans chapter 10. And this is what they say: how beautiful on the mountains are the feet of the herald who proclaims peace, who brings news of good tidings, who proclaims salvation, who say to Zion, your God reigns. And Paul in Romans chapter 10, in verse 15, he reiterated that verse and he says, how beautiful are the feet of those who bring good news. And so when they looked at this and they said, it's about readiness to proclaim the gospel. And I would say, absolutely, we need to be ready. We need to have our feet shod with the message of the gospel of peace, prepared to give this message. But then on the other side, it's a readiness that comes from the gospel of peace. It's that readiness that comes when I understand and I know my salvation, when I understand that I have peace with God. There is something of a stability that you and I can have when we are convinced, when we know that I have peace with God. I do not have to strive. I don't have to struggle to somehow find peace with God. And as I was preparing, and I wanted to, and I said, God, show me when to do this. And I just really believe that this right now is, there's people who are striving and struggling, whether it's here today or whether it's those who are online. But there are people who are struggling and striving to determine whether they are acceptable to God. You are looking, you say, I don't know. I don't know if I have peace with God. I don't know if God has accepted me. I don't know if he loves me. I don't know. And you see, we ought to know. As believers, you got to know you have peace with God. Because if you don't know your peace with God, then guess what? Satan can come and he can take you off in every direction. He can, in fact, he can tell you then, you know what? Ed, you've got to do this and this and this to be acceptable to God. Oh, I know that Jesus died. Oh, I got that. And he can agree with that. But he can, if he can get you to believe that you have to do works, you have to do all these things to become acceptable to God, then what has happened is the cross has lost its power, because now you have to go and do it yourself. Did Jesus' death, did it accomplish it all? Is there anything more you have to do to add to that death to find salvation? What do you think? Yes or no? No. His death was enough. It's not by works, lest any man should boast. You see, so often, if the devil can get you to do the works, if he can get you to do the work of the law, and you've got to live this way to so that you can be acceptable to God, then what happens is we've saying to God that his blood was enough. Jesus' blood wasn't enough to save me. I want you to know God's, the blood of Jesus was sufficient. And when you strive and struggle, am I worth it? Have I been worthy? Has God made me worthy? Am I worth God saving me? God says, yes. Look at my son. Am I acceptable to God? Because you see, God knows all my faults. If I could only make myself better, then maybe God will accept me and forgive me. All my good works is like filthy rags. I'm acceptable before God because of Jesus, and that's it. That's all I stand on. When we talk about grace, we also have to understand that grace is more than just forgiveness, but it is power for us to live a godly life. I don't live a godly life in my own strength. I must depend on his grace through faith. If I am pushing to try and be that in that place because of I think I have to, then it becomes works again. Grace, grace, wonderful grace. Oh, that we would get a hold of this view of grace again. And it's this grace that is the message of the gospel of peace. Psalms 89 and verse 14, it says, righteousness and justice are the foundation. That's that preparation. It's that that readiness is that word, foundation. Righteousness and justice are the foundation of your throne. Mercy and truth go before your face. Again, Ephesians 6 and verse 15 says, it's having done all to stand, stand firm. The armor was first of all to help the believer to stand and then to withstand. If you cannot stand, you cannot withstand. I want to read you verse 15 of chapter 6 in two different versions. And it says this, Ephesians 6:15, and your feet sandaled with readiness for the gospel of peace. That's being prepared to give reason for the hope. The NIV says this, and with your feet fitted with the readiness that comes from the gospel of peace. And then the Amplified says this, and having shod your feet in preparation to face the enemy with the firm-footed stability, the promptness, and the readiness produced by the good news of the gospel of peace. What the Amplified Version did is he took both sides of it, and I believe that that's the way we ought to look at it, because it brings them both together, that we are both ready to proclaim the gospel, but also ready because we understand the gospel of peace and we're standing firm in it. So just as a Roman soldier had his shoes with spikes to help him stand firm in different terrains in the battle, and different so the believer needs to be sure-footed when it comes to standing and advancing against the schemes, against the assault, against the working of the enemy in your life. And again, we need to stand against Satan to stop him from trying to destroy us, to render us ineffective and unfruitful. This preparedness or readiness that comes from a sure-footedness to the believer comes from the gospel of peace. You need to know the gospel of peace, and we're going to come to that in just a couple minutes. So how do we put on these shoes? How do we make sure these shoes, how do we make sure the gospel of peace is firmly fitted around us? And I don't want to just say it's around your foot, but it tells us to shod our feet with the preparation of the gospel of peace. What does it mean to shod something? That's a word that we just don't use. It means to bind up, tie around tightly around one's foot. And in the context that we're talking, that which is we are to bind tightly to our feet is the gospel of peace. It needs to be tight and not loose around our feet. And that tightness and that it brings us that sure-footedness and the stability that a believer needs. The gospel is the good news of Jesus Christ. The gospel is the good news that Jesus came, died, rose again, and lives. And he came to dwell within us by the Spirit of God. It was this gospel, this good news, that changes our lives. So this gospel is the good news of Jesus, and we have to be, we have unity and closeness. This peace that comes in is peace is the unity and closeness with God. Or do you have closeness with God? Or do you feel always far away? Where do you feel in when you come before God and in your prayer time? Do you come before God begging and pleading, oh God, will you hear me? God, will you hear me? Or God, I know that you are always with me. You see, we have to know where we stand. And that's that closeness, that gospel of peace that God brought us close and near to him. So now I'm going to give you a little bit of another story. If you were to look at my shoes at home, if you were to look at my running shoes, one of the things you'll notice, and I don't know about you, I should take a look at where everybody at. I keep my shoes untied or tied up very loosely, because then I can stick my feet in quicker. You know, I'm lazy. I don't want to do them up, so I just keep them. I used to tie a knot at the end of the shoelace. Keep them wide open, then it's easy to flip in and out, slip in and out. As you can tell, I don't wear laces on my shoes now because it's easy to slip in and out. But when it comes to wearing shoes, and I also had this, and my confession is good for the soul, I guess. But I used to go and I'd sit with the parents as I'm trying to sell shoes to their child, and the parents would say, please tell my youngster they have to tie up their shoes. I says, you have to tie up your shoes. I was obedient to tell them that they had to tie up their shoes. You should tie up your shoes. Meanwhile, my shoes weren't tied up. And that's, you know what, it's not the do as I say, or do as I say, not as I do. But here it is. If I was to go with my shoes like that, my running shoes, and I'm going to go hiking with Dennis and Doc, and my shoes are left open, and I'm either going up the mountain or going down a trail, what are some of the things that can go wrong if I'm on a heavy hike with my shoes like that? Yep, I can twist my ankle. And that's a very big reality. How many have ever twisted their ankle because their shoes weren't done properly? Yep, been there, done that. You know, not even hiking, you know. And so what ended up happening is that would your ankle would be twisted and then you're stumbling along. The other thing that would happen is just lose your shoes altogether. I've been running before with my shoes untied, and all of a sudden, poof, off goes the shoe. And then you have to stop, you have to go back, and you have to get it and everything. Anyways, making sure your shoes are firmly tied on your feet. And it's the same thing with sports. If you're going to go and play football or what other sport, if you don't properly tie your shoes firmly on your feet, they cannot support or benefit that which they were supposed to be used for. And a soldier in a battle is in real danger if his shoes are not tied tightly. Picture a soldier out there, spikes on there, he's got everything set, but they're not tied tightly to them. And they wanted to start to battle, and they plant their feet. Next thing you know, their feet go out because it's not tight. So in like manner, the Christian, the gospel of peace must be firmly in place. The gospel of peace will give a solid foundation so that you and I can stand. There's an old saying that goes like this. If you don't stand for something, you'll fall for anything. What are you standing for? Is your stand firmly planted in the gospel of peace, or are you standing on something else? Are you standing on sand that quickly slides away, or is it on the solid rock in Jesus Christ? For the Christian, without a solid stand on the gospel, the good news of Jesus did on his life, death, and resurrection, they can be blown away by every wind of doctrine. They can be blown around by any person who decides they're going to come in and teach something. And if you don't understand, if you don't know what the gospel of peace is, you can be easily pushed aside. You'll stop resting in the grace of God. Let me give you three different scripture passages. Matthew 24, verse 11. 1 Timothy 4, verses 1 and 2. And 2 Peter 2, verses 1 to 3. And each one of these things speak, in the last days there will be false prophets and false teachers that will lead people astray. And the reason they're led astray is because they don't have the belt of truth, they don't have the breastplate of righteousness, and their feet are not properly shod with the gospel of peace. In the last days, there's going to be teachers and false prophets that are going to come, and they're going to try and teach you or lead you into a different path that you have to live by works and not by grace and faith alone, by grace. Through faith alone. You see, we have to have a firm foundation. Paul even spoke to the Galatian church and asked them this. He said, did you receive the Spirit by the works of the law or by believing what you heard? Did you receive Jesus by believing and trusting in that? Or did you receive Jesus by doing all these great works? Again, it's not by works, lest any man should boast. And we're no different from them, because you and I can be misled if we don't have that solidness around our waist, our breastplate, or our shoes. One such teaching that Paul had to deal with was that area of works rather than faith. In other words, what they were doing is good outweighing your bad. Do you know that most of the religions of today, you can go back, and that's the very essence of everything. If your good outweighs your bad, you get to go on. But understanding that, you know what, our good does not outweigh our bad. It never can. So if you take your Bibles, you're still there. Ephesians chapter 2. And Paul did not leave us without understanding the gospel of peace. You see, if you've already taken note, every piece of the armor Paul has already previously talked about. And he's doing the same thing in Ephesians chapter 2. Verses 8 and 9, he says, "For you are saved by grace through faith, and this is not from yourselves, it is a gift of God, not of from works, so that no one can boast." You see, he's already given us this. Faith comes by grace. Now, I'm going to give you a little overview, and you can walk through this. So it's Ephesians chapter 2, all the way from verse 1 to 22. And I've put them down in points so that we're not reading the whole thing. But let me give them to you this way. Number one, we were all dead. We were all separated in our trespasses and sins. That's where we were. Number two, we were by nature children under wrath. God's wrath was already set upon us. This is where we live. Number three, the words, "but God." You see, when we see where we were, and we come to this point, "but God made us alive in Christ. He raised us up with him and seated us with him in heavenly places in Christ Jesus." So where are we seated right now as believers? In Christ, in heavenly places. We are seated with Christ, and it says he's seated far above all principalities and powers. You see, our position in Christ is there. Although we walk on this earth, we need to understand this is where I'm seated. And because I am seated, now I can walk with an authority that comes because I'm in Christ. We were without Christ. We were excluded from citizenship of Israel. We are foreigners to the covenants of the promise. And we were without hope and without God. This is who we were. This is, again, the gospel of peace. This is who you were, but God. But God came in Christ. But now in Christ Jesus, you have been brought near, for he is our peace. Colossians chapter 1, verses 21 and 22 says, "Once you were alienated and hostile in your minds, expressed in your evil actions, but now he has reconciled you by his physical body through his death to present you holy, faultless, and blameless before him." You were once separated, but now you can be presented before him, faultless. Number two, he made both groups, the Jew and the Gentile, both one through the cross. He proclaimed good news of peace to those who are far away and peace to those who are near. Through him, we have access to the Father. You have access to the Heavenly Father because of what Jesus has done. That's the good news of the gospel of peace. I have access. I can come in without fear. I can come in before him, not because I've been doing everything right, but because of Jesus and through his blood. We've been brought through. He proclaimed the good news of peace to those who are far. And through him we have access, and therefore we are no longer foreigners and strangers, but fellow citizens, members of God's household, growing into a holy temple for God's dwelling in the Spirit. This is who you are. You've been placed in that place where God's Spirit dwells, and we are being made into the temple of the living God where he can dwell and live and walk through us in our world around us. This is the gospel of peace, that we have first of all peace with God, and we also can proclaim that others can have peace with God, because they, right now, if they do not know Jesus, are those who are separated and under God's wrath. Can I give you a spoiler alert? This is it. We've been told that the shoes is a gospel of peace. The helmet, and that's the good news that we are brought near to God. The helmet is the helmet of hope. The helmet of salvation is the hope that we have for eternity. Our world right now don't have hope for eternity. They're looking at now and they go, all they hear is the bad news, and they're looking and go, what's the use? Why do I stay? But there's a hope. Why do I continue to press in when all the struggles are there? Well, there's a hope that we have in Christ. Spoiler alert. So when we come to the winds of adversities, trials and struggles, when all these things come against us, I want to remind you to do this one thing. Are you ready for it? Be calm and put on the whole armor of God. when the winds of adversity, when struggles come and hit you, and it sometimes is dead on and you see it coming and it's going to hit you, be calm and make sure you put on the whole armor of God. Stand with the truth around your waist. Stand with righteousness on your breast as breastplate. Stand firm with your feet because you know that you've been brought near to God. You have peace with God. You are not alone, but He is with you and He will always walk through with you. Our enemy, the devil, Satan will use every opportunity to litter our path with distractions and traps. Our enemy will put the spikes up so that we would end up getting hurt. And only the shoes God gives us as part of the armor can give us the protection we need to keep moving safely across the battlefield. And it's these same shoes that give us sure-footedness in every situation. When troubles come, do you fall? Do you slip and slide? Or are you sure-footed? Because struggles are going to come. You're always going to face struggles. But are you firmly standing in the gospel of peace? We need to make sure that we have the full armor of God on. Do you have the gospel of peace firmly tied on? Or are you sure of your salvation? If not, if you're not sure of your salvation, I'm going to encourage you to come and talk with me. Because the scriptures say that these things are written so that you might know that you have that you are saved. You don't have to sit there and wonder, oh, I don't know. If you don't know, and those online, if you don't know, come and talk to me. 1 John chapter 5 will talk to us about this. And if you don't know Jesus as your personal Savior, if you have never received this free gift of forgiveness, I want you to know, and whether you're online or here this morning, if you have never accepted Jesus as your personal Savior, you're still in your trespasses and sins. You are still standing in a place separated from God. And that was not God's plan. For God so loved the world that He gave His one and only Son, that whoever would believe in Him would not perish, but have everlasting life. God sent Jesus so that you can have that place of peace with Him. That's the gospel for you. God wants you to come into a relationship with Him. He wants to walk alongside of you and help you. God gave Jesus to die for your sin and for mine. He took the penalties so that through trusting in Jesus, you can have peace with God. Romans 10 verse 9 says, if you confess with your mouth Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised Him from the dead, you will be saved. It's not just about praying a prayer. It's about recognizing that you've been separated from God. God sent Jesus so that we can have a relationship. And it's about turning back to Christ, back to God, and say, God, come. So if you're watching today or here on in person and want to give your life to Christ, if you want to receive this free gift of salvation, I'm going to invite you to pray this prayer with me. Just pray, Lord Jesus, I'm a sinner and I need your salvation. I believe you died for me and rose again. I now call upon your name and ask you to save me. Thank you. Amen. If you have accepted Jesus this morning, if you prayed that prayer, you've been brought into relationship again. There's peace that God has promised you. And this gospel of peace can give you that sure-footedness, that stability, so when wind comes and everything will come against you, you can stand firm. You know what? You also have, when you accepted Christ, you have others around you, that we come together with the shield of faith and we put it together and we can stand together against these things that the enemy would throw at us. So if you did this, if you've accepted Jesus this morning, I'm going to ask you to either tell somebody, tell me, put it online, put a comment online that you've accepted Jesus. And I want to get a hold of you. I want to talk with you. And just share with you some more. So as we continue on and as we come to an end, I'm going to invite the worship team to come up. And we're going to sing one more song. Tina left. We're not going to sing another song. Hey? She's... All right. All right. So we're not going to. We're going to pray instead. And I just want to invite you to please stand with me. And I know I went over time. And it seems like I always seem to. Forgive me, but I think it's so important for us to understand this truth of our feet properly fitted, tied on that gospel, that you would stand strong in this gospel of peace. Let me pray for you. Father, I thank you for Jesus. I thank you that he came and he died for us. Thank you, Jesus, for being willing to pay the price so that we could have a relationship with you and with the Father again. We've been separated. We've been without hope. We have no relationship. We have no peace. We've been under wrath. And yet, in that time, even while we were yet sinners, you came and you died for us. And I pray this morning for those who don't know Jesus, that they would turn, and even today, even consider this place, that they would turn to you, Father, and receive you. I pray, Father, for each one in this place who maybe they're not sure of their salvation. Maybe they struggle when the winds of problems and struggles, or maybe people are trying to say things, and they have missed it, and they're asking the questions. Father, I pray for them. The Father, that you would speak to them about your peace, that they have been brought near through the blood of Christ. And that place of nearness cannot be changed because, God, you hold them. And that they can know that they are saved. And Father, I pray for each one here. Lord, as we move through this week, Lord, I pray that you would awaken us to the message of grace, that you would awaken us to understand that we are not trying to do this in ourselves, and it's not by works. We don't have to prove ourselves to you, Father. Father, we stand in a position now because of the blood of Christ. And so, Father, right now I pray, Lord, that we would firmly put the gospel of peace around our feet so that we might stand in the evil day, in the days when there's winds of trials and struggles. We commit this to you now and this next week, Father, in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, the Lord bless you. You have yourself a good week. If you need prayer, I'm going to invite you to come and we'll pray with you. And if not, you are free to go. So, Lord bless you and keep you.